morning, everyone, and I'd like to welcome you all to Basingstoke Baptist this morning. My name is Megan and I'll be your host. Just before we start, I'd like to take us first to the book of Psalms in 148, and it reads, "Kings of the earth and all the people, all the princes and all the judges of the earth, both young men and maidens, old men and children, let them praise the name of the Lord, for his name alone is excellent. His glory is above the heavens and the earth." So I'd like to encourage us this morning as we enter into a time of praise, just to meditate on the greatness of God. Sometimes, you know, when we come, we get used to just singing songs and they're just words, but let us focus on what the words are saying and praise his name. We won't have a worship team this morning, but the words will be projected on the screen. So I'd like to invite you all to stand as we sing our first worship song, Praise is Rising.
The Lord will reign forever. Your God, O Zion, to all generations. Praise the Lord. Amen. We're going to continue our worship this morning. We're going to sing Hosanna, Praise is Rising. We want you guys to join in with us.
Praise is rising. Eyes are turning to you. We turn to you.
Long for you.
'Cause we're we turn to you. We turn to you. We turn to you.
Do please take your seats. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you that you are the God who meets us in our situations. We thank you that in your presence our fears can be washed away. And we want to honor you this morning. We want to give you our worship and our praise, our love and our adoration. You are a glorious King. Praise your name, King Jesus. Amen. Okay, I'd like to invite the children to come and join me here at the front, if you would please. Either sit on the front row or just find a place. You need to be facing this way because I'm going to show you some pictures on the screen. So sit on the floor or sit on the front row of chairs. That would be brilliant. Okay? Excellent. Good. So what I want to do with the children is to introduce something I'm going to pick up again with the adults later on, and that is to look at the story of, or the beginning of the story of a lady called Ruth. So Elimelech and his wife, Naomi, had two sons, Mahlon and Chilion. And they lived in the town of Bethlehem in Judah. When the town was hit with a famine, they decided to leave to find food. I forgot to say one thing. While I'm reading this story out to you, what I'd like you to do, children, is to identify the names of three women. There are three women in this story. I want you to see if you can, at the end, tell me what the names of those three women were. Also, one of those women makes a fantastic promise. And I want you to see if you can remember what that promise is, and we'll talk about that. So there they are, Elimelech and his wife and their two sons, Mahlon and Chilion. They decide to find food. So they travel to the nearby land of Moab and settle there to live. The Moabite people did not worship God but their own idols. Sometime later, Elimelech died. The two sons grew up and married local Moabite women, Ruth and Orpah. Sadly, tragedy struck again. 10 years after the two sons had settled in Moab, Mahlon and Chilion both died. It left three widows, Naomi and her two young Moabite daughters-in-law, Ruth and Orpah. When Naomi heard that the Lord had provided food for the people back in Bethlehem, she decided to return. The three widows packed up their belongings. Naomi then told her two daughters-in-law, "Go back to your own mother's homes. May the Lord show you the same kindness you've shown to your dead husbands and to me. May God help you find new husbands." Naomi kissed them both, and they wept aloud. "We will go back with you to your people," they replied. "No, you must return home," Naomi insisted. "You can marry again." Naomi felt embittered and that God was against her. Orpah and Ruth wept again. Orpah kissed Naomi goodbye and returned home to her mother's house. Ruth, however, clung hold of Naomi and would not let go. "Orpah has returned to her people and their God," said Naomi. "Go back with her." "Don't urge me to leave you," Ruth replied. "Where you go, I will go. Where you stay, I will stay. Your people will be my people and your God will be my God. Where you die, I will die." When Naomi realized that Ruth was determined to stay with her, they both set off on the road to Bethlehem. They arrived back in Bethlehem just as the barley harvest was beginning. Their arrival caused quite a stir. Naomi's grief and suffering had changed her appearance so much that many did not recognize her. "Can this be Naomi?" people asked. "Don't call me Naomi," she insisted. "Call me Mara," which means bitter. "Because God has made my life bitter. I went away full, but the Lord has brought me back empty. The Lord has brought misfortune on me." Okay, so children, what was the names of the three ladies? Yes. Naomi was one, excellent. Yes. Ruth was another. Yeah. Orpah, well done, yes, absolutely right. That's Orpah was the third lady's name. And what was the, who made the promise? What was the promise that the ladies made? Can you tell me who made the promise? Yep. Ruth. And do you remember what promise she made? Yeah, she promised that she would stay with Naomi, didn't she? And that was quite significant because it meant that she was leaving her own people and going back to a strange land to be with her mother-in-law. It was a very precious thing for her to do for a mother-in-law because she had no one to look after. Her husband had died. She had no prospect of getting remarried. There was no social security. There was no pensions. There was no means for her support. And so her daughter-in-law coming back with her was a wonderful promise that she made. And there was no guarantee. I mean, if you read the rest of the book, it's only four chapters long, so you could read it very, very easily. But if you read the rest of the book, you find that Ruth does get married and wonderfully becomes part of the line of people that eventually results in Jesus being born. But she had no promise at that point that she would get what she was, get anything from her promise. She said, "Where you go, I will go. Where you stay, I will stay. Your people will become my people. Your God will be my God. Where you die, I will die." You can't commit more to someone than that. And that's the kind of commitment Jesus asked for us, that wherever he goes, we will go. Okay? So thank you for listening so well. Do go back to your seats. And I think we're going to sing again. Yep.
Your name, the mountains shake and crumble. At your name, the oceans roar and tumble. At your name, angels will bow. The earth will rejoice, your people cry out. Lord of all. Lord of all the earth will shout your name, filling up the skies with endless praise, Yahweh, Yahweh. We love to shout your name, oh Lord.
At your name.
At your name. The evening breaks in glory. At your name. Creation sings your story. At your name, angels will bow, the earth will rejoice, your people cry out. Lord of all the earth will shout your name, filling up the skies with endless praise, Yahweh, Yahweh. We love to shout your name, oh Lord.
Lord of all.
Oh Lord of all the earth will shout your name, filling up the skies with endless praise, Yahweh, Yahweh. We love to shout your name, oh Lord.
There is no one.
And there is no one like our God. We will praise you, there's no one like our God. We will sing, there is no one like our God. We will praise you, there's no one like our God. We will sing, there is no one like our God. We will praise you, there's no one like our God. We will sing, we will sing. you, praise you, and Jesus is our God, we will say. Lord of all the earth, we'll shout your name, shout your name, filling up the skies with endless praise, endless praise. Yahweh, Yahweh, we love to shout your name. Oh, Lord of all the earth, we'll shout your name, shout your name, filling up the skies with endless praise, endless praise. Yahweh, Yahweh, we love to shout your name. Oh, 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 oh. We love to shout your name.
My name is Jenny, and I'm going to lead our prayer time today. When our Queen ascended to the throne, there was a period of preparation before her coronation. The then Archbishop of Canterbury, Geoffrey Fisher, wrote for the Queen a book of daily devotions with Bible readings and prayers. And today I'd like to use some of those Queen's prayers, the prayers that she prayed in her devotions prior to her coronation, to guide our prayers today. Let's pray together. These are the Queen's words in her devotions. The whole of life is a journey to God. In its course are many lesser journeys taken for many different purposes. Sometimes the Bible records special journeys undertaken for special purposes, in answer to a call from God. Such will be my journey to Westminster. It will be undertaken in obedience to a call from God. I have not chosen this office for myself. He has appointed me to it, and I go to be consecrated to it by him. And these are her prayers. Lord Jesus Christ, you are the way, the truth and the life. Keep me from wandering from your ways. Help me to trust you, the truth, and to be filled with your life. May your Holy Spirit teach me to live the right way, to be truthful, and to be filled with your life, living to please you. Amen. We thank you, Father, for blessing us with a queen who trusted you, who looked to you for guidance, who steadfastly held to her calling in times of blessing and times of challenge. We pray that you will help each of us to follow her example and trust you wholeheartedly wherever our paths take us. When considering unity and peace, this is what the Queen prayed. Lord Jesus, let the love of all who will be present in the Abbey to witness my coronation, and of all who will hear the service or see it from afar, surround me and uphold me, that they and I together may dedicate ourselves, our souls and bodies, to that true and reasonable service which shall be acceptable unto thee. Amen. We thank you, Father, for our Queen's selfless dedication and service to our country and Commonwealth. We raise to you, Lord, our Queen's prayer again in preparation for her son, Charles's coronation. We pray for Charles and the royal family that you, Lord, will uphold and strengthen them with peace and fortitude in their sorrow. We pray, Lord, that as Charles is crowned king, that your Holy Spirit will come upon him in wisdom and power to enable him to dedicate himself to this royal service by your grace. We pray also for ourselves, Lord, as witnesses to this coronation, that your Spirit will move across our country and our Commonwealth, that each of us will put our trust in you and play our part in reasonable service that is acceptable to you. When the Queen was thinking about duty, this was her prayer. Into thy hands, O Lord, we commend ourselves. Be with us in our going out and our coming in. Strengthen us for the work that thou hast given us to do. Defend us with thy heavenly grace, that we may continue thine forever and daily increase in thy Holy Spirit more and more, until we come to the everlasting kingdom. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We thank you, Father, that you graciously guided our Queen throughout her long reign. Thank you for her daily devotions with you that sustained her. Thank you that she now rests in joy and peace with you in your everlasting kingdom. We pray for each member of the royal family, from King Charles to the youngest great-grandchild, that each of them would come to know Christ as their friend and saviour. Finally, we are going to have a minute's silence to remember our Queen and to thank God for all the gifts that he blessed her with. So if you would stand with me, if you are able. I will read you the Queen's prayer on the last evening of her coronation, and then that will be followed by our minute's silence. Lord, this day thou hast been gracious unto thy servant. Thou hast filled my cup with the goodness to overflowing. With a humble spirit and a thankful heart, I commit myself to thy care and will lay me down in peace and take my rest. Amen. Amen. Please sit down. There's one final prayer for us in this book from the Queen. So this is for all of us to share. God be in my head and in my understanding. God be in mine eyes and in my looking. God be in my mouth and in my speaking. God be in my heart and in my thinking. God be at my end and my departing. Amen. We're going to continue our worship with two songs of worship. The first one is Blessed Be Your Name, and the second one is Raise a Hallelujah. Please stand up to sing.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. And blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. And blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Every blessing you out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
In the presence of my enemy, I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated.
Very sad news to share with you. We have just received a telephone call to let us know that our friend and brother, David Fish, has died. So would you join me in praying for Anne and the family? Father God Almighty, we want to thank you so much for David. Father, we thank you for his stalwart walk with you. We thank you for his steadfastness in face of all the medical challenges that he has faced over the last few years. But most of all, Lord, we thank you for his love of you. And we thank you that we are firm in our conviction that he now resides with you. But we would pray for his family, Lord. We particularly pray for Anne. Lord, in this really hard time, when she will be sorrowful, we pray, Father, for your peace upon her, for your gracious mercy and blessing to be known to her and to their children and their grandchildren. Watch over them, we pray, in these coming days. Sustain them, we pray. And may they lift up their hearts to you, that even in this storm, that they will see your grace and your mercy and your blessing. In Jesus' name, amen. If the children would like to go to their groups now, thank you. And we pray the Lord's blessing on you, that you will have great fun together and that you will learn a bit more about Jesus as you go and share. And what we neglected to do earlier, David, was to actually introduce you. So this is David Grant. Many of you will recognise him. He has come and shared with us previously from the One Church. So let me just pray for you as you speak with us, David. Father, we thank you for bringing David here to share with us. We thank you for his preparation, for how you have already been speaking to him. And we pray, Lord, that he shares your word with us now, Lord, that you would speak loudly and clearly into each of our hearts and that we would be moved to respond. And we pray for him too, that as he speaks, there will be a blessing of your spirit in his heart too. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, good morning again. It's lovely to be here with you. I do really enjoy these opportunities to come and share with you. And I consider it a great honour. And I know that when I get a text or a message from David Bishop, and he says, would you come? I think, yes, I'm going to be able to go and be with those lovely people again. So, as I indicated talking with the children, I want to spend some time this morning thinking about the first chapter of the book of Ruth. I'm not going to read the first chapter to you again because I more or less covered it all in a slightly simplified version by doing what I did with the children. But I think what would be helpful is for us just to reflect on the fact that what it was like at that time. So the book of Ruth nestles between the book of Judges and the two books of Samuel. And it was a time in Israel's history where they didn't have a king. They went through a cycle of people that were called judges who came and rescued the people from the various enemies that were all around them. It was a bit of a cyclical process because there would be a crisis in the nation, they would be rescued, they would turn away from God again, and they would cry out to God and God would raise up another judge and so on. And the very end of the book ends with this phrase that says that in those days Israel had no king and everyone did as they saw fit. And that's an interesting phrase, everyone did as they saw fit. I guess there definitely were some people who were very, very godly people who maintained their faith and were faithful to the Lord. But typically, the nation descended into a godless behavior and mixing with the nations around them, worshipping foreign gods and things like that. And at the start of this story, we're in a season when we don't know whether there was a judge in control or not, but there's a man in Bethlehem who has two sons and a wife. His name was Elimelech. His name is a fantastic name. His name means, God is my king. You don't get much better names than that, do you? My God is my king. If you're a Christian, that's what your name is. My God is my king. And his wife's name was Naomi. And again, another beautiful name. Her name means pleasant or lovely. And they're facing a crisis. The crisis is that there is famine in the land. And although they live in a place close to Bethel, which was meant the bread basket, it was the house of bread, a place that was supposed to be a place of plenty, they were facing a famine. And they wondered what to do in that time of crisis. And so Elimelech decides, taking leadership for his family, that he will take his family to seek refuge in Moab. Just before we think about what that meant, let's just pause for a moment to think about where we find ourselves today, because I think that there are many parallels between Israel at that time and the crisis that Elimelech and Naomi faced and where we find ourselves. We live in a nation, don't we? Live in a world where everyone seems to do what seems right in their own eyes. Now, there are many, many good people who love and serve the Lord across the nations and in our nation. And we've had a wonderful example in our Queen, and our prayer is that Charles will pick up that mantle and live in that as well. But equally, there are many people, and I don't want to get political today, but we could perhaps quite quickly number some people who have very prominent positions in our society who just seem to do whatever they think is right in their own eyes and don't have any kind of moral compass that seems to guide them in what they do other than they do what they see fit. We also see the parallel because we live in a time when there are many refugees travelling across the world, whether they're escaping from wars or famines or persecution for all sorts of reasons. And I don't know, maybe even there's some of you who've welcomed some of the Ukrainian refugees into your homes. Certainly there are Ukrainian refugees who have been welcomed into homes in Basingstoke. And Elimelech and Naomi are refugees. They flee from Israel to Moab in the hope they will find food and find safety and security. It was also a time of famine would be a time of economic insecurity. And as we think about the cost of living rises and the challenge of energy price rises, and maybe even, I don't know, could we even face rationing of sorts for our fuel or for maybe even food, some foods later in the year or early next year? I don't know if that'll happen, but economic uncertainty, economic crisis, we face that, and that would have been the experience of this family. So Elimelech makes a decision for the sake of his family, for their security and well-being, to provide food to them. He decides to go to Moab. And you might think, well, that doesn't sound like such a terrible idea, until you recall the fact that God had specifically told the nation of Israel not to intermingle with the nations around them. And in fact, the Moabites were picked out specifically as one of the people who were not permitted to come into the assembly of God's people. And so to go to Moab was to go into the heart of, if you like, the most godless nation that you could possibly go to. And so Elimelech, whose name says, "My God is King," decides to go to a place that worshipped Chemosh and practiced child sacrifice and do abominable things in order that he might provide security for his family. And to begin with, it seems like it kind of works because his family is provided for and they have two boys. One is called Mahlon and one is called Kilion. Interesting names to give your sons. Mahlon means sickly. Kilion means failing. I don't recommend any of you who may be expecting to have children to call your children by those names. But that's the names they were given. And I think that kind of expresses the insecurity and the difficulty they were facing as a family. And those names come to be kind of prophetic because although the boys grow up to become men and they marry Moabite women, again, something that God expressly forbade his people from doing, both Elimelech and the two boys die. And you have these three women. Naomi, who is a little bit older, probably past the age of having children herself, certainly past the age of any expectation of being able to get married, of an age when she would be becoming more dependent upon her sons and their sons' families to support them. And the two women, Orpah and Ruth. And so we see that Naomi, who is in one sense one of the heroes of this book, but she only gets mentioned a few times, we see Naomi reach this point where she now has a fresh crisis because the place she'd gone to, the place she'd sought security with her husband, has now become a place of great, great sadness. But she has heard that back in Israel, the harvest has set in and there's plenty of food there, and she decides, well, perhaps now is the time for me to go home. I've got nothing left here. These women are probably going to marry other men and have families, and they probably won't take care of me. Let me go back to my own people. And so she sets off on this journey, and the two women go along with her to see her on her way. And Naomi's plan is that when they get to the border and she starts to cross over, then she'll send the two back to go and back to their mother's homes and to have the opportunity to get married. But these women have seen something in Naomi, despite the fact that later in the story that we read today, she says, don't call me Naomi, meaning pleasant or lovely. Call me Mara, meaning bitter. Such was the pain that she felt in her life. I wonder if any of you ever feel like that, that you feel like your name is bitter. But they've seen something in her, and I think quite probably Naomi did maintain worship of the Lord. I don't know whether the men did or not, but I think that there was something about her that was a kind of an ongoing practice of faith that her daughters-in-law had seen. Because although Orpah decides to go back, Ruth makes this incredible decision. This wonderful, wonderful, one of the most beautiful statements, I think, that you see in the Old Testament, where she says that, don't send me back to my own people. I want to come with you. I want to stay with you for the rest of my days. I want to go wherever you go. I want your people to become my people. I want your God to be my God. Where you stay, I will stay. Where you die, I will die. And there I will be buried. May the Lord deal with me, be it ever so severely, if even death separates you and me. And so when Naomi realized that Ruth was determined to go with her, she stopped urging her. Isn't that just the most beautiful statement of commitment and love that someone can make to another person? And the fact that she says, your God will be my God, seems to suggest to me too that she understood that this wasn't just simply the commitment of a woman who loved an older woman, wanted to show respect and care, but actually that there was a faith beginning to develop in her into the one true and living God. And at the point that Ruth makes that incredible statement of commitment, that incredible promise, she doesn't know the end of the story. She doesn't know what returning to Israel would be like. When they head to Bethlehem, they're met, and the people say, is that Naomi? And it wasn't simply just because she was in the distance and it was a bit hazy. She'd become haggard and gaunt. The years had not treated her well, and she was only just recognizable. Her sadness and her grief and her bitterness had made her lacking in hope. But for Ruth, she was moving into a strange land. She was moving into a land where she would be a foreigner. She was moving into a land where not only would she be a foreigner, but she would be a foreigner from a land that was hated by the Israelites, an enemy, a land that God had said they should have nothing to do with. So she was making this wonderful step of commitment to Naomi and to Naomi's God, to our God, that was taking her into a place where she didn't know what the future would hold. I guess many of you in this room know the story of Ruth quite well, so you know the outcome. You know that there's this wonderful romance that kind of develops with Boaz, and he provides for Naomi and for Ruth from the gleanings of the harvest. And then actually Naomi remembers that he is what's called the kinsman redeemer, which means that he actually does have an obligation under Israelite law to marry Ruth, I guess, or Naomi, but to marry Ruth. And the process develops, and she gets married, and Boaz and Ruth. And Boaz is probably more Elimelech's age, I suspect, than Mahlon and Chilion's. He was certainly an older man, because he makes comment about that, how honored he is that she didn't look to some of the younger men for this obligation to be fulfilled. And then they go on and have children, and in that line you get King David, and as I indicated with the children, carrying further down the line, we discover that Ruth is named in the genealogy of Jesus as one of his ancestors. So she is a key part to play in the history of salvation, not just for herself and for Naomi, but for God's people and for us. But at the end of this chapter, where Ruth makes that promise, she doesn't know that's going to happen. She has no idea what the future will hold and whether her commitment to Naomi is actually going to be a life of hard work and poverty, and what would happen to her when Naomi passes on and Ruth is left alone. So I think with these three characters, Elimelech, Naomi and Ruth, we see three different ways that people can respond to a crisis. And we all face crises, don't we? I don't know if you are anxious about the cost of living rises and fuel costs and things like that as we start to feel the chill of the winter weather starting to settle in, even though it's a glorious sunny day. Or maybe there's other crises, health crises, or crises in your family, crises in your work. We all face crises at certain points in our lives. How are we going to respond in those crises? Are we going to be people who are like Elimelech, who do a pragmatic thing, find solutions that kind of seem to get us through? And maybe in the short term it will seem to go okay with us because we've made those decisions and we feel justified in making those decisions. But they're decisions which aren't based on faith in God. They aren't decisions that come from a heart of obedience towards God. And who knows what the ramifications of that will be in terms maybe of loss of faith or loss of ultimate security. Or maybe we would respond a bit like Naomi, who I think had faith. I think, you know, she knew that Bethlehem was a place she could go back to and that there would be some kind of support for a poor old Israeli woman, Jewish woman, who didn't have any means of support. But she didn't do so joyfully and eagerly and with delight. She did so with bitterness and sadness and resentment in her heart. She felt that God had kind of dealt with her harshly. Or can we be people like Ruth? People who maybe are outsiders. People who would be overlooked. I think one of the beauties of this story and of so many characters in the Bible is that God chooses people that no one else would choose. God chooses people who are marginalized in society, who are stigmatized in some way. There are five women listed in Jesus' genealogy. Tamar, who was guilty of prostitution. Rahab, who was a foreign prostitute who came into the nation. Ruth, who was a Moabite. And Mary, who of course became pregnant before she was married. All five women, there was stigma associated around their circumstances and their situations. And yet God chooses people like that, men and women, in order to fulfill his purposes. So maybe this morning you are feeling anxious. Maybe you are feeling marginalized. Maybe you're feeling like a foreigner in a strange land. Would you be able to respond like Ruth, and say to, in one sense, say to this church, where you go, I will go, where you stay, I will stay, your people will be my people, your God will be my God. But more crucially, would you say that to Jesus? Would you say to Jesus, where you go, I will go, where you stay, I will stay, your people will be my people, your God will be my God. Not knowing what the outcome will be. I can't say to you, if you make that kind of commitment to Jesus this morning, that your circumstances will get better. I can't say that if you make the promise to Jesus like that, the lights won't go off this winter. But what I do know is that in the long term, when we make a commitment to Jesus like that, we will find our place in God's big story. And our destiny will be to spend eternity with him, where there will be no more sorrow and crying, where there will be no famine, there will be no heartache. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that in the pages of the Bible we see time and again unlikely people meet you and make a commitment to follow you and to serve you and to be people of God. We thank you for this example in this story of Ruth, who had such love for her mother-in-law and took such a great bold step of faith. Lord, we thank you that she did that not knowing what the outcome would be, but we thank you too, the outcome for her was glorious. She found a good husband, she had a family, she was able to provide and became the great-grandmother of King David and ultimately the great-great, however many greats there are, grandmother of Jesus. And so this morning, Heavenly Father, as we face crises of our own, crises in our own lives and our personal circumstances, crises in our nation, we say that we want to be people who will follow you every step of the way, that all our decisions will be guided by what would bring glory and honor to your name rather than what would be pragmatic or convenient for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So let's make a response together by singing a song which is kind of based around this story, which says, it's called "Where You Go, I Will Go. Where You Stay, I'll Stay." Let's stand together and sing.
You go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow. All your ways are good, all your ways are sure. I will trust in you. My side, high above my life.
Amen. As we come to a close this morning, thank you so much for the message. It was a challenge to us all, how we respond to the situations in our lives. So something to think about. When we're faced with situations in our lives, do we choose our own way and try to figure things out? Do we go back to God, but with hardness of heart, going back, kind of sulking and saying, okay, Lord, I'm back now, what now? Or do we choose to go before God and say, okay, Lord, I'm trusting in you. I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know what my future holds, but I'm committed to your promises. I will be loyal, Lord, to what you say. I will be obedient, and I will see with the eyes of faith. For us this morning, Ruth was a parallel of faith. She could have, like Orpah, decided to go her own way, choose her own path, start over. But that one decision, she became not just a part of the genealogy of Christ, but she was recorded in our book of faith as a model for us. That even though we may not know where God is taking us and we face sometimes extremely difficult situations in life, that God sees, he does see, and when his time comes, he will restore. But it's up to us to say, okay, Lord, I'm not going to choose my path, even though your path may not be the easiest, but I will trust in you. And look at what the fruit of trust brings. So shall we pray? Father, we thank you for your word, and we pray, Father, that you would help us to see the eyes of faith. It's so easy, Lord, to make a plan and to just do our own thing, Lord. But Father, I ask that you would soften our hearts towards you, that Father, we would be committed and loyal, that Father, where you say we should go, we will go. What you say we should do, we will do. Where you say you want us to be, we will be. And Lord, your name will be glorified when people see that transformation of you taking us out of those situations, that your name and your name alone would be glorified. Amen. Amen. Go in peace, and thank you all for joining us this morning. Thank you.